he has become a legend, a victim of tragedy, who emerges as a symbol of justice.
What the hell are you?
I'm Batman.
But what drives a billionaire to become a crime-fighting vigilante?
You got an angry man in pain, seeking purpose in his life.
And how do Batman's motivations reflect our own?
He is struggling with the very things that you and I struggle with every day.
Now, go inside the mind of a superhero.
His whole life is a quest to restore meaning.
As we use the real-life tools of analysis.
There's a technique for people who have fears. It's called exposure.
To unlock the psyche of Bruce Wayne, Batman, and the villains who symbolize our darkest desires.
I am gonna stop you. You're just a freak. Like me.
The brainchild of creator Bob Kane, Batman debuted in the pages of Detective Comics in 1939. It was the decade of the Great Depression, urban expansion, and violent crime. Since then, billionaire Bruce Wayne and his masked alter ego have been shown as everything from a mob-crushing crime fighter to a kid-friendly superhero. But by the end of the 20th century, Batman had taken on a darker, grittier, and more realistic tone as writers and filmmakers began adding layers of psychological motivation. In the early 20th century, Swiss psychiatrist Carl Jung explored the link between the conscious and the unconscious mind. Jung believed that in all of us, a struggle wages between the socially acceptable self and what Jung called the shadow side.
Batman embodies the shadow side. He looks like evil. He operates like an evil guy.
Where are you?
Here.
He operates outside society, and yet his values are the values of a virtuous man. He is a perfect union of the two sides of all of us, the good and the evil that coexist in human life.
Theatricality and deception are powerful agents. You must become more than just a man in the mind of your opponent.
In the film Batman Begins, Bruce's choice to take on the identity of a bat not only taps into his own childhood fears, but into the fear most people have about the flying creatures.
In popular culture, a bat is a threat. It comes out at night. It's something you can't really see, but it can bite you, can suck your blood.
So what Batman does is take the iconography of evil. Look at medieval paintings of devils, demons. They have often horns and bat wings. Bats in every culture except the Chinese that I know about are symbols of evil, of the dark side, of death, of Satan. And that fascinates us. People are always fascinated by evil, partially, I think, because it's an unacknowledged part of every one of us. And Batman puts that in your face.
Why bats, Master Wayne?
Bats frighten me. It's time my enemies shared my dread.
History has a lot of examples of people taking symbols that are initially negative, initially hateful even, and getting ownership of them. In the Nazi era, homosexuals were branded or forced to wear a pink triangle. Well, in recent decades, the pink triangle has become a symbol of liberation for homosexuals. Bruce Wayne's done the same thing. He's taken a symbol of all that is scary, unpredictable, and chaotic in the night, in the world, and owned it.
By the same token, you could say that the choice of a bat, which is able to soar above society, upwards towards the heavens, represents this aspirational purpose or dynamic that seems to be motivating his behavior.
Well, you took my advice about theatricality a bit literally.
He's created this symbol, and that symbol can't have limits. He can't show weakness ever. And so you have the fight between what is good for Bruce Wayne and what is the right thing to do for Batman. And the two of them are not always compatible.
Of course, There are other ways of channeling anger and loss, like psychotherapy.
Well, why doesn't Batman just go into therapy? Why does Bruce Wayne just go into therapy and then be cured of Batman? The reality is that the Batman persona is the true persona, in our opinion, the way we handle the stories, and that Bruce Wayne is the mask.
Batman's just a symbol, Rachel.
No, this is your mask. Your real face is the one that criminals now fear.
Which is the true man? The Bat or Bruce Wayne? Since the birth of the superhero era, a lot of psychologists have talked about the multiple roles that we play in everyday life. There's an identity that we play with our spouses, identity we play with the coworkers who work beneath us, and the coworkers who work above us.
For Batman, you've got the billionaire playboy, which I think most people would say is not the real person, and that's just a persona, it's an act. Then you've got Bruce Wayne when he's not playing the playboy, and then you have Bruce Wayne when he's wearing the Batman costume. They're facets of the same core personality.
Which is the real identity? Is it Bruce Wayne or is it Batman? And I think the really cool answer, of course, would be to say, oh, it's Batman. But I think that that misses the point. What defines the character is the essential humanity that Bruce Wayne possesses.
You are my greatest student. It should be you standing by my side, saving the world.
I'll be standing where I belong. Between you and the people of Gotham.
The core of his identity always remains Bruce, because it's his formative experience as Bruce that fuels both. Batman is a tool he puts on to accomplish what he needs to do.
If Batman's true personality remains a subject of debate, so do his motives for fighting crime. History and fiction are filled with figures who remind us that one person's hero is another person's vigilante.
In the letter of the law, Batman is a vigilante. He has identified the white and the black, the right and the wrong, and lives by that code much more strictly than anybody else does. Laws are open to interpretation. Batman's law is not.
Where were the other drugs going?
I don't know. I swear to God.
Swear to me!
We have always glorified various vigilantes, whether we're talking about Robin Hood, robbing from the rich and giving to the poor. There is this persona that makes us feel good. The problem is that when we start engaging those behaviors in an organized society in a way that allows the citizenry to make a determination about who should be punished and how and when, we run the risk that their idea might not match up with the idea of the masses.
What he's doing is really outside the law. But as a citizen of Gotham, he really didn't have any choice because the law was so corrupt, he couldn't work within the law. But on the other hand, Batman has one rule. He will not take a life.
I will not become an executioner.
He's got systems that he orders his behavior by to try and restrain his natural instinct for violence or for revenge or whatever dark impulses that drive him.
A lot of what makes him Batman is the ability to control himself, to be able to be disciplined. In many situations in life, success requires that we regulate our impulses. Somebody drives into a parking space ahead of us, and instead of ramming into him, which I'd love to do, I suppress that. I exert self-control. Self-regulation is like a muscle. We have, all of us, a muscular ability to regulate our impulses. Bruce Wayne is a man who's developed that muscle. He has worked that muscle out. So now he has a stronger capacity for self-regulation than anyone else. That's almost his superpower, the power of self-control.
If you finally learn to do what is necessary, I won't kill you.
Occasionally, Batman's critics have accused him of suffering from a hero complex, an obsessive compulsion to help others and right wrongs, as defined by psychologist Carl Jung.
Batman has this obsession with keeping things under control and making sure that the law is obeyed and that the innocent are not hurt. But his obsession leads him to pretty much cut out from his life anything that doesn't add to his mission as Batman.
He's obsessive compulsive about that. I brought a story once where he's in the middle of an important business meeting, and it's late in the afternoon. He's discussing $1 million business, and he starts paying attention, and he's simply watching the sun go down. And the second the sun vanishes behind the horizon, he goes, "Meeting's over, I've got to go."
He cannot stop being Batman. It's much easier to stop being Bruce Wayne. So once you understand that, then you can understand why he is motivated and why he continues to behave in the way he does.
Though Batman recognizes the line dividing justice and injustice, other Gotham creatures of the night see no such distinction.
Kill the Batman.
Of all the evildoers in Batman's universe, none is more explosive or unpredictable than the homicidal nemesis known simply as the Joker.
Come on, help me!
He represents a kind of chaos, of meaninglessness, of randomness, the idea of the character of the Joker, just the luck of the cards.
Here's my card.
Introduced by DC Comics in 1940, the Joker initially had no backstory. Over the years, several versions of his history have been written, describing the character's maniacal metamorphosis. One involves a tragedy in which the Joker fell into a vat of chemicals and became disfigured as a result. The accident not only changed his appearance, but also twisted his mind.
You don't know what makes him tick. Maybe he won't kill you. Maybe he'll hand you $1,000 bill. He'll probably kill you, but you can't be sure. So in that way, he's a perfect villain for Batman.
Most characters can justify the terrible things they do as, I'm doing this for my family, I'm doing this because the world hates me, I'm doing this because, pick an answer. The Joker does it because I'm as nutty as a squirrel, and I'm proud of that.
Some men aren't looking for anything logical. They can't be bought, bullied, reasoned, or negotiated with.
Evening, Commissioner.
Some men just want to watch the world burn.
Let's put a smile on that face.
Most criminals are motivated by the desire to gain greater wealth or gain greater power.
Les, I have kids to feed.
Well, you don't like falafel?
Or to exact some form of revenge. There's a clear motivation, which is understandable, for what's prompting their behavior. In the case of somebody who's mentally ill, you can't necessarily predict what they're going to do because their motivations are not the normal ones.
For example, an individual such as John Hinckley, who believed amidst his psychosis and narcissism that if he were to assassinate the President of the United States, Jodie Foster would fall in love with him. You see quickly where the logic in that line of thought falls apart.
Why so serious?
And the Joker has an agenda of chaos. He's a unique villain in that he is not even necessarily after money or power or any of those traditional things. So that's really the hardest kind of evil to fight because you can't bargain with it.
Well, hello, beautiful.
In the Dark Knight, the battle between Batman and the Joker is taken to the ultimate level.
A little fight in you. I like that.
Then you're gonna love me.
I always felt, as Batman, that there was a great curiosity about this Joker because he hadn't come across anybody like him before. This is another character like himself who will not compromise whatsoever.
I think the Joker is the logical response to a character like Batman.
If I
partly because Batman, having raised this extremity of behavior in Gotham, he's putting on a mask, tapping into people's fears. And there's all of the technology he employs. He's distinguishing himself to fight crime.
Now there's a Batman.
And that immediately raises the question of, is he prepared to go outside the law? How far is he prepared to bend the rules?
They are dark reflections of each other. They're both men who operate outside of normal social norms. They're both highly talented, highly gifted at what they do. So they have a lot in common.
Every yin has a yang, every positive has a negative. Batman is sane and logical, uses his mind to solve problems and solve crimes, and the Joker is a complete raving lunatic.
Batman says, philosophically, we can acknowledge an imperfect world, we can acknowledge that we have to step outside of social norms, but that doesn't make the social norms meaningless. The Joker says, the presence of random injustice means that there is no justice. The fact that innocence can be destroyed means there is no innocence. So your life is a joke. Now, when someone says your life is a joke, that's a challenge. It's not just a physical challenge, it's a moral challenge, it's an intellectual challenge. And Batman can't let that go. Because the Joker isn't just threatening him physically, he's threatening the premise of Batman's existence. That's why it's such an epic discussion that they're having. And of course, it's played out physically, it's played out in fights and punches and gunshots. Ultimately, it's a philosophical conflict, and not one that's easily resolved.
The Joker wants to see that everybody has a price, that nobody is pure, and that even Batman can be bought or can be leveraged in such a way that he would compromise his principles.
Holocaust survivor Viktor Frankl talks about the last of the human freedoms. It's the attitude one is going to adopt towards life. That's the fundamental choice that we retain no matter what we are experiencing, no matter where we are.